you have done. For Lord, you are the Messiah. You are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And Father, we thank you for this day, for your goodness, for your grace and your mercy. And Father, we pray that in this service this morning, that you would pour your Spirit out upon us. Touch every heart and soul. Fill us full once again with the anointing and the power of the Holy Spirit in Jesus' name. And Father, we pray that every song that is sung, every word that is spoken, Lord, that it all be done to bring glory and honor to your precious name. That name that's above every name, that in the name of Jesus, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that you are Lord to the glory of God the Father. Touch us, we pray today in Jesus' name. Hallelujah to his name. Hallelujah, oh Jesus Messiah.
Oh, Jesus. as I struggle alone. They say
praying on the Lord's side.
side are you depending on?
Depending on the Lord's side.
Hey!
Deserted. Despite the raw wind and the stinging sleet, everyone had gathered in a cry of panic and terror down at the riverbank. Anxiety, watching, waiting to see what would happen in the perilous icy flood. Everyone in the whole town was there, everyone except Matt Corbin. But then, who was Matt Corbin? Who cared where Matt Corbin was? No one. Absolutely no one. Matt Corbin was a nobody. No one cared where he lived or died. Let alone whether he was with the townspeople, whatever was going on. Matt was the poorest boy in town. He had no home and no family. 4 years earlier, Matt's parents had died in an epidemic, and Matt was left an orphan, utterly destitute. Other children in such cases were sent to the poorhouse to be cared for or bound out to someone as sort of a servant, but not Matt. He refused to go to the poorhouse or to become a bound boy. He refused to take charity. He would work. He would pay his own way. He declared he could take care of himself. And sure enough, by working hard at many jobs, sawing wood, rolling barrels on the wharf, picking apples, weeding gardens, or doing whatever job was offered him, he managed to eke out a living. At least he usually got enough to eat and some clothes to wear. He slept in an old warehouse shed by the owner's permission if Matt would act as a watchman for the place. This morning, trying to make enough money to buy a little food to keep soul and body together, Matt had been out since daylight in Mr. Grissard's wood shop chopping wood. That's why Matt knew nothing of the tragedy at the river. But then, what did it matter? Nobody figured Matt counted for anything. Why bother to tell him? At last, Matt finished the pile of wood and went up to the owner's house to collect the pay, but no one was there. Up and down the street he went, but the town was empty. At last, he looked down a cross street and saw the crowds in the distance gathered at the riverbank. What would be wrong? Matt ran. He ran as fast as he could to find out what happened. Why would such a crowd be at the river in this terrible weather? Nobody paid attention to Matt, but his sharp ears soon learned what the excitement was all about. Tom Martin, a fisherman who has also ran the ferry boat from one side of the river to the other, had attempted to row his ferry skiff across the river. It was a horrible mistake. The river was rising rapidly, and before Martin had gone a distance, the ice broke up. There was no way to escape. The boat was caught and crushed in the ice. The father was drowned. Somehow his wife, with her children in his arms, clung to the wreck of the boat and was carried by the icy current to low-lying island. What a tragedy. There stood the poor, helpless woman out on the frigid island, drenched by the icy water, shivering in the bitter cold water, separated from all the earthly help. Now the island was nearly underwater as the great swollen river rose restlessly. In an hour or two, the river would sweep over the whole island, and the great fields of ice would crush the woman and the baby and carry them to a horrible death. The mother's pitiful cries for help could not be heard through the whistle of the winter wind. But when at last she held up her poor little baby toward the people on the bank in a silent, piteous plea for help, all their hearts agonized. Many made suggestions for rescue, but none gave any hope of success. It would be impossible to launch a boat. The vast fields of ice were crushing and grinding down the river, turning, twisting, and sometimes jamming, sometimes drifting apart, leaving wide open spaces between. A man might as well get out of the eggshell as in the strongest rowboat such a raging river. There was nothing that could be done. There was no way to help. The woman had a little baby who surely perished in that icy, watery grave. Help was out of the question. Everyone on the riverbank agreed on that, everybody except Matt Corbin. Without a word, Matt disappeared from the crowd. Half an hour later, someone pointed upstream and cried out, "Look, who's that? What's he going to do?" Looking upriver, the people saw someone in the distance standing on the field of ice. He had a big farm basket strapped to his shoulders. He was carrying a huge plank. As the ice field on which he was standing neared another, the boy ran forward, threw the plank down, making a bridge of it, crossed to the further field. Then he picked up his plank and waited for another chance to cross as he worked his way down the river with his plank. Everyone strained to see. "Look," someone cried, "look, it's Matt Corbin. He's trying to cross to the island." A great shout went up from the crowd as the people realized what a heroic attempt Matt was making. But a hush fell just as quickly as they realized the extreme danger he was in. What a boy he was. His plan was wonderful, but oh, it was impossible. There was no way he would succeed. He would surely be drowned and crushed between the ice. Now not only the woman and child would perish, but Matt would too. The ice was moving rapidly. Matt's greatest danger was from the smaller fields of ice. When he had to step on one of them, his weight would make it tilt and make his footing unsure. He was finally near the island. There seemed to be nothing but small ice cakes. For a little while he waited, hoping a larger ice block would drift near him. But soon he knew he couldn't delay. He would soon float past the island. It was now or never. He would either have to try his weight on the treacherous broken ice or fail to save the woman and the baby. Carefully, he chose one of the strongest looking ice floes, laid his plank down, and passed across without harm. But on the next try, the ice cake tilted and gave way, and Matt went down in the water. A shudder went through the crowd on shore. "Matt," they screamed. "Oh no, he's gone." "Poor boy," explained one. "It's all over for him now." "No, look, look," shouted another. "He's trying to climb back up on the ice. Hooray, he's on his feet again." And a shout of joy went up from the crowd. Somehow Matt has managed to regain his plank and climb back on the ice before the ice fields around can crush him. Then moving even so cautiously, he made his way, little by little, inch by inch, to the island. "Hooray, hooray, he's there at last," shouted the people on shore. "But how will he get back again?" they asked. "Will he get back again?" Getting to the island was battle enough, but the hardest task was still ahead. It was one thing for an agile, active boy to work his way over the floating ice, but it's quite another to carry a child and lead a frightened, half-frozen woman across. But Matt was quick, sharp, and brave. He meant to finish the job he had begun. Taking out his knife, he made the woman cut her skirts off at the knee so she could walk and jump more freely. Then he placed the baby in the basket, strapped his back, and cautioned the woman to be calm and not give way to fear. Carefully, Matt waited for the larger ice cakes to drift to him. Patiently, he held the plank steady for the woman to cross over. then carried the baby, he too crossed to the next ice field. Excitement and tension mounted as the crowd anxiously watched on shore. Now, as a young lad near the shore with his precious treasure, fears mounted whether they would be able to make the embankment. How terrible it would be to have made it this far and then to be lost so near safety. Breathlessly, the crowd waited. Then, finally, with one last effort, Matt helped the woman off in the ice and onto solid ground. At last, too, he leaped ashore with the precious baby in the basket. A great shout of joy and relief went up, and the people almost trampled each other, trying to get a close enough look to shake the hands of their hero. But their poor hero was hardly able to stand. Drenched to the skin and chilled to the bone, he stood stiff and almost lifeless on the shore. A doctor had been called, took charge of the woman and baby. Another lifted Matt into his carriage and took him to his office. With the doctor's care, Matt soon got warm and revived. Matt Corbin was not a nobody anymore. He was a town hero. What Matt did for that woman and child was a heroic deed, and he deserved praise. But the rescue he made was for this life only. What Jesus Christ did for us at Calvary was much greater cost. As the woman and child were helpless out on the ice due to certain death, so we as sinners were helpless and lost in sin, doomed to eternal death away from God and His mercy. But Jesus Christ loved us so much, He died for our sins. He sacrificed His life that we might live. Jesus says, "I lay down my life for the sheep," John 10:15. As a woman trusted the boy to lead her to safety, so we must trust Christ to give us eternal life and take us to safety in heaven. There is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved, Acts 4:13. As a woman crossed on the plain to safety, so Jesus Himself is the bridge to heaven. Any other support on which we depend will fall short and plunge you into eternal or certain judgment and death. The town could no longer ignore Matt Corbin. He proved his concern by his heroic action. Jesus proved his love by his death and resurrection. You cannot ignore him, Hebrews 2:3 says. How shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? So that's what, and I guess the title of, you know, some sermons have, this one was like, No Hope. But it says, "Praise be to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He has given us a new birth into living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." That's in 1 Peter 1:3. He has given us a new birth into living hope through the resurrection of Jesus. In the light of God's love, we are spiritually born into a living faith. God freely gives us new life. We are forever changed as we become children of God. When we are spiritually reborn, God gives us a living hope within our hearts. That living hope is Jesus. Whatever we face in our day-to-day living, Jesus is there giving hope in hard times and handing out cheer in good times. He died for us and rose again so we may have a living hope, a real hope, solid and sure. Without Jesus Christ, you have no hope. In the Bible story from Acts chapter 9, verses 1 through 22, Saul is a lost soul. He is blinded by all the world around him. When God actually blinds Saul's eyes, he can finally see. We too can be blinded by the shoulds in life, like the kind of clothes we should wear, the type of car we should drive, or the kind of neighborhood we should live in. We need to open our eyes like God did for Saul and see God's real purpose. In Romans 12:12, God tells us to be joyful in hope. And Hebrews 6:19 says, "We have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure." Remember to trust the living hope that's alive and well in Jesus Christ. Call on Jesus. If you don't have living hope, you can't have it today. Reach out and ask Jesus into your heart.
Amen. Simple message. Easy enough for anyone to understand. The Lord Jesus Himself reminded us that unless we humble ourselves as a child, we can't enter the kingdom of heaven. I remember the story of Jesus and the disciples were gathered together and the disciples were talking to Jesus and asking Him the question. They were always concerned about themselves. They always wanted to know, what kind of a reward are we going to get? What's in it for me? And so they asked Jesus, "Which one of us is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" I can only imagine what it would have been like. And they're gathered there talking to Jesus, and they're bragging about the different things that they have done and the different works that they have accomplished and the different amount of, some of them probably went out and had witnessed to many people and had seen many people baptized and made all kinds of converts. And now they come back to Jesus and they're telling Jesus all that they have done and all the things that they have accomplished. And they're saying, Lord, which one of us is going to be the greatest? Which one of us is going to get the biggest reward? Which one of us is going to get to sit beside you on the throne? Jesus set them straight really quick. He said, unless you humble yourself, you're not even going. Unless you humble yourself, you're not even going. Don't worry about what kind of reward we're going to get. Don't worry about what's in it for us. It's all about Him. And that's the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Unless we humble ourselves before Him, seek first His kingdom and His righteousness and all these other things will be added unto us. Yes, God is our provider. Yes, He is our healer. Yes, He's going to do great and mighty things for you in your life. But seek first His kingdom. That's His will. A lot of people start off in life and they're trying to say, Lord, why am I here for? What is your will for my life? What's the most important thing? The most important thing, humble yourself before God. Seek first His kingdom, His righteousness. Amen. All these other things will be added to you. I've heard it told time and time again. People, they come to Jesus Christ. They get saved. They get filled with the Holy Ghost. They get baptized in water. They start paying their tithes. And God begins to bless them. But you know what? Just because we're saved, just because we're obedient to the Word of God, does not mean that life is going to be perfect. See, as long as there's sin in this world, we're going to have problems. We're going to have sickness. We're going to have pain. There's going to be things that we go through in life that we don't understand. But one thing we do know, we know in whom we have believed. We know that there is a God in heaven who sent His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And so this morning what I want to do is this. We are about to go through a kids' crusade here at Howe Assembly of God, and there's going to be boys and girls coming. I've had calls from people from Fort Smith and Van Buren that are planning to be here for Kids Crusade. And there's people across this community and this county that are going to be here. We've knocked on doors. We've invited people. It's been in the newspaper. It's all over the internet. And so I'm believing God to see boys and girls' lives changed by the power of Jesus Christ. This evangelistic couple that's coming, Brother Robert and Jan Teal, they've been preaching kids' crusades every day throughout these past few months, with the exception of one week when she was severely sick. But God is using this family. They're seeing boys' and girls' lives changed. It's been reported in our district council services that they're seeing boys and girls filled with the Holy Ghost. Boys and girls that have been healed, and not only in the kids' eyes, but also and the moms and dads, the grandmas and grandpas. They're coming to the kids' crusade too. And the message, just like we heard this morning, a simple message, simple enough for a child to understand, but yet so simple and so sincere that it speaks to the hearts of every individual. And moms and dads are coming to the altar. One lady came in with her child. The child had been going to church already. The child was already saved. But when the mother heard the gospel story of how Jesus was a healer, she came to the front, gave her life to Jesus Christ, and requested prayer for healing, and was healed. Other boys and girls filled with the Holy Ghost, other kids have now said that because of being filled with the Holy Spirit, they want to go into the ministry. They feel like they're called to preach. Sister Shelley, don't ever take for granted what God does through you in children's ministries. Moms, dads, grandmas, grandpas, your children, your grandkids are watching you. Watch where your feet go. Watch where your tracks are leading, because if you look behind you, there's a little boy, there's a little girl that's trailing right behind you. And they're watching you. And they're going to go exactly where you go. Watch your actions. Watch the words that you speak. Watch the places that you go. Because your children will grow up to be just like you. Some time ago, at another church, we were doing a heaven and hell drama. And there was a skit between a father and a son. The son had gone to church that morning. The dad come by the church to pick him up. The dad asked him, "Well, son, how was church today?" The son replied, "Well, dad, it was really good. The songs were great. The preacher did okay. I almost went to the altar and gave my life to Jesus Christ." He looked at the dad and he said, "Dad, I've noticed you've never done that." The dad smiled and said, "Well, son, your mom has enough religion for both of them. She goes to church Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. She goes to women's ministry meeting. You know, it's not religion that got us these things, it's these hands." And the son smiled and he said, "Well, thanks, Dad. You've encouraged me. When I grow up, I want to be just like you." And the moment he said that, a car hit them head on. They both died. And they were standing in eternity. And the son looked at the dad, and the dad was weeping and crying. And the dad told the son, he said, "Son, I've been so wrong. I've been so wrong." And the boy said, "What do you mean, Dad? You said Mom had enough religion for both of us." "So I was selfish, son. I had too much pride to go to an altar. I had too much pride to let people see," and he shed tears in front of the church. "I had too much pride to give my heart to God in front of all those people." And all of a sudden, as they slipped into eternity, the devil come out, took the dad by the hair of his head, and he said, "Thanks, Dad. We almost lost that boy. But thanks to you, he's mine." I want to tell you this morning, children are watching. They're watching everything that you do. And when they grow up, they want to be just like you. Is the life you're living the life that you want your kids to live? Is the lifestyle that you've chosen to live, is that what you want your kids to do? Is that what you want for your grandkids? With every head bowed and every eye closed, please, no one leaving. I don't know the names of every individual that's here, but I do know that there are some children who have done some remarkable things these past couple of weeks. One little girl in this church, raised in this church, 4 years old, 4 or 5 years old. She met a lady the other day, invited her to church. She came to church. She was here last Sunday. Another girl that's here today, 4 years old, told her mom she wanted to come back to church. She's here. Her aunt's here. I'm telling you, if little kids can do that, then every one of us should do everything that we can to reach out and tell someone about Jesus. So if you're here this morning, I'm going to make this as broad as I can. If you're here today and you're not ready to meet Jesus, in other words, if you don't know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of your life, if you don't have that assurance to know that if something was to happen to you right now, if God was to call your name and to take you into eternity, would you be ready to meet Him? Or would you be headed to a place of suffering? Would you be headed to a place called hell? Heaven forbid, people that sit in this sanctuary that have heard the gospel of Jesus Christ, what a tragedy it would be for them to spend eternity in hell, lost forever without Jesus. But this morning I'm giving an opportunity for anyone that's here today. You say, "Pastor, I'm not ready to meet Jesus, but I want to make sure. I don't want to have any doubt, but I want to know beyond any doubt. I want to know that I'm ready. If Jesus was to call my name, I want to know that I would be ready to see Him." It's very simple. Jesus gave all that He had for you and for me. And the Bible says that if we confess our sins to Him, that He will forgive. If we confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus Christ, believe in our heart that God has raised Him from the dead, we will be saved. That's the promise of the Word of God. The Word of God says there's no slack in His promise, that He's not willing that any should perish, but that all would come to repentance. For He loves each and every one of you. He wants our lives to be lived for Him. If you're here and you're not ready to meet Jesus, but you want to make Jesus Christ Lord and Savior of your life, just lift up your hand and put it back down, and we want to pray with you. We're not going to embarrass you. We're not going to single you out. In just a moment, I'm going to invite the entire church to come to the front. If you're here this morning and you say, Pastor, I want to be saved today. I want Jesus Christ to save my soul. I want to be free from sin. I want to be free from the things of this world. If you're here today and you need Jesus Christ to save your soul, can we stand across the sanctuary together? Can we come to this front and let's just gather around this front and let's lift up our hands toward heaven and let's thank Him for His love. Thank Him for His grace. Thank Him for the precious blood that He shed on the cross of Calvary. And let's ask God to pour His Spirit out upon this church and upon this children's ministry as we have this kids' crusade, that there will be boys and girls come from the north, the south, the east, and west, that they will come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of their life, that they will be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, that there will be healings that will take place, that there will be a difference made in the moms and dads and the grandmas and grandpas. Lord, we come to You today, Father. We thank You, Jesus, for every boy and girl that we're able to minister to. Lord, we thank You that we have an opportunity to run a church van and to bring boys and girls to church, that we're able to feed them physically and spiritually. And God, we pray for Your anointing and Your power of the Holy Spirit upon this kids' crusade. God, that You would put a special anointing and the power of the Holy Spirit upon this children's church evangelist. God, that You would bless the Teal family, Lord. Let them bring the Word of God under the power and the anointing of Your Spirit, God, that through every boy and girl that walks through the doors of this sanctuary, that they will feel Your love, they will feel Your power, that they will feel the glory of God into their life. And Father, we pray that lives would be changed, that people would be set free by the power of Your Spirit, Lord, that there not be one soul left behind, but Lord, let us go out into the highways and hedges and compel them to come into Your house, that it may be filled. Lord, we pray that You will touch families, God. Lord, that the moms and dads come to know You. Let the grandmas and grandpas come to know You. Lord, we pray for healings. We pray for Your anointing, God. Lord, whatever Your will is for this kids' crusade, Lord, Thy will be done. And Father, we give You all the glory, all the honor and the praise, for Lord, You alone are worthy, Jesus. And Lord, we thank You. And we bless Your name. Hallelujah to Your name. Hallelujah to Your name. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus.
Thank you for watching today. If we have reached you, we would like to hear from you. You can visit us online at howeag.com, or you can write to us at First Assembly of God, P.O. Box 97, Howe, Oklahoma, 74940. We invite you to worship with us at First Assembly of God, Sunday morning Sunday school at 9:30, morning worship at 10:40. Sunday evenings at 6 and Wednesday evenings at 7. We also invite you to subscribe to our online YouTube channel or visit our Facebook page. We hope that you can join us again soon for another service from First Assembly of God in Howe, Oklahoma.